guys, welcome to my channel. My name is ReadingBear, and I hope you are ready for some more stories. And today, we'll take a look at some new entitled people content. If you enjoyed my content, please don't forget to subscribe to my channel and post some bear emojis in the comment. And now, let's dive right into the stories.
The first story is titled, Trashy Neighbors Built Trailer Park Next to My Land and Ruined My Property. TLDR. People in trailers illegally move into the land next to me. The trailer park is loud, and the people are white trash that drink and scream. One of them tries to sneak over on my property and steal a chicken. They start making a mountain of trash that is gross, and that is the final straw for me. I let the IRS know that their company isn't declaring anything and trying to get away without paying taxes. Then I call CPS and tell them that the only times I have seen the kids outside the trailer, they looked very sick. They got taken away from their parents who were deemed unfit to take care of them. Finally, I built a wall of manure on the property line to make them so uncomfortable that they left. A farmer is not the kind of guy that you want to make an enemy out of unless you want him to get so much revenge you leave. This is a story about how I got the best revenge imaginable on the people that used to be my neighbors. I use that term loosely because first of all, the land next to my property wasn't owned by anybody, but that didn't stop this family from parking their three trailers there. The simplest way to describe these people would be the term white trash. I don't really have high standards for people because I am a farmer and I know that some rich snobs probably look down on me as well. These people though were next level and spent their days drinking, screaming, cursing, and more drinking. It turned out that they actually did have a job and owned some waste removal company. I guess they were just busy spending all the money on beer. I also saw plenty of lotto tickets lying around that I can only assume came from them. Now I basically hated these neighbors and wanted exactly zero to do with them. They weren't on my land, so I just tried to mind my own business and take care of what I needed to do. I have some chickens, some cows, and a small area for vegetables. I just wanted to be out here living my best life despite them. The first problem happened when I caught one of them trying to steal my chicken. One night I heard a ruckus and went outside to see one of them near where I fence in my chicken coop trying to cut it open. I can only assume the plan was to steal a chicken, but the second that he saw me, this guy bolted back to his trailer. I couldn't ignore these people and had to keep on high alert in case they tried to pull anything else. That wasn't the only issues with these neighbors though. I understand that some people aren't exactly neat, heck, I'm a little messy myself. Now since they didn't own the land, they didn't actually get trash picked up by the town and instead had to deal with it themselves. This ranged from them moving it out where I keep my garbage to doing nothing at all. I didn't care if they put trash out with mine because it was getting taken away anyway. I guess it became too hard for them though because they just started letting things pile up outside near the property line. A mountain of trash started to form, and I was disgusted going anywhere near that side of my property. It was a huge health hazard, and that was when I decided I had enough with these guys. I was going to get some revenge and teach them a lesson. Now, since they were very loud, I could always hear them bragging among themselves how they didn't declare any taxes for their business. This way they didn't pay anything for it and talked about how much money they would save doing this. I used this knowledge to my advantage and made a little call into the IRS that the company doing waste management for most of the town wasn't declaring anything. I knew after a while this took effect because I could hear them yelling from one trailer to the other about the IRS auditing them and which one of them let it slip what was going on. They didn't even suspect I had anything to do with it and I wasn't done. This next thing I don't know if I would really classify it as revenge or just doing the right thing. I know that I briefly mentioned how horrible the conditions these people were living in before, but I neglected to say that they had kids living there too. Kids that I never saw go to school and were mostly kept locked in the trailers all day and night. Kids that were always dirty and surrounded by adults just getting drunk and leaving trash everywhere. They were mostly kept in the trailers and the few times I saw a kid, they looked sick to me. I couldn't just look at this and do nothing about it. Instead, I called Child Protective Services about my concern. A black car pulled up and a lady in a suit started knocking on the doors of the trailers and speaking to the people inside. I guess the conditions were bad enough that they actually took the kids away. I know that foster care isn't the best environment, but please trust me when I say that I wasn't getting their kids taken away as some sort of sick revenge. They clearly weren't being cared for, and I wasn't going to just sit around and watch that display. In fact, Seeing that made me even angrier at them and wanted to give them one last piece of revenge, this one bigger than anything else. Since I had livestock and crops, it was within my rights to have a nice big compost piles on my property, courtesy of my cows. I decided that the perfect place to put it would be right on the property line between me and the trailer park neighbors. For those that don't know what these compost piles smell like, you don't want to. Farmers are a little more used to it, but these people certainly had this as a new smell for them. I hadn't seen them hanging outside of their trailers for a couple of weeks because it smelled too bad for them to go outside. For the first time in months, I didn't hear screaming and cursing coming from them. I guess the smell finally got too much for them because that was the final straw for them to pack up their trailers and move out. I drove them away and I didn't feel bad about it one bit. They didn't own the land, were making it a disgusting place, and even dragging innocent children into the whole thing. I don't know what they did after that, but I want to think and believe the best. I want to imagine that they got their acts together and found a better place to live. I want to imagine they were able to get their children back and treat them right from then on. The only thing I do know for sure was that their company was not in charge of the town's waste management anymore, and looking up online I can't even find it. So, they either went bankrupt or started up again under a different name and let the scam continue. All I know is that I am enjoying the peace and quiet that I bought this land for in the first place. The chickens and cows are the only neighbors that I need at the end of the day. If someone buys that piece of land, good, but if someone else takes it over and starts trouble, I have no problems getting some revenge again. The next story is titled, "An Entitled Mother Rips Open the Doors on My Ambulance, and It Does Not End Well for Her." So, this just happened last night, and I still can't believe someone would do this. I'm a 30 male and a paramedic. I've been in EMS for the past 8 years, and I absolutely love my job. Last night, we were dispatched to a 75-year-old female who fell at home. The patient stated that she tripped over her carpet and hit her head when she fell. We arrived on the scene and noticed that the home was a duplex with our patient's door on the right and her neighbor's door on the left. We made our way into the home and found her lying on the floor. The woman was awake and breathing. We started asking her the standard questions: are you okay? Does anything hurt? Do you remember the fall? Etc. She stated that she has a pounding headache and that she remembers walking to bed and then waking up on the floor. In my field, that's a pretty big red flag. We notice that she's got a pretty good lump on the side of her head and a big bruise starting to form already. Noticing the bruise, I asked her if she was on any blood thinners. She said that she was on blood thinners for a previous stroke she had a few years ago. We urged her to let us take her to the hospital because there was a possibility that the fall could have caused a bleed in her brain, and she should go to the hospital to get some scans done. She agrees, and we begin to package her up. We applied a C collar around her neck in case of any C-spine, neck, injuries. She denied any neck or back pain, so we lifted her up and placed her on our stair chair. A stair chair is exactly what it sounds like. It's a chair with tracks that we use to carry patients up and down stairs. As we were getting her out of the house, her neighbor whipped the door open and started yelling about how she couldn't sleep with all the lights and noises outside. The sound of the stair chair apparently woke her up, and she was not happy about that. My lieutenant walked over to her and apologized and said that we were dealing with a medical emergency and that we would be leaving soon enough. The Karen neighbor then noticed that our patient was her neighbor, and that's when she started yelling about something totally different. The entitled neighbor started yelling, "You can't take her to the hospital. I have errands to run tomorrow, and she needs to watch my kids." My lieutenant again reiterated that we were here for a medical emergency and that her health is more important than her errands. The entitled neighbor let out a loud huff and then slammed the door in his face. We thought that was the end of it. We were wrong. After a few minutes in the back of the ambulance, we told our lieutenant that he could take the engine crew back to the station and that we were going to be heading out in a few minutes. After we checked her vitals, got an IV going, and started giving her IV fluids, my partner got out of the back and went up to the driver's seat. About 5 seconds later, the back doors of my ambulance fly open, and who do I see? The entitled neighbor, of course. Apparently, she needed a few minutes to get dressed before coming outside. I yell at her, "What the hell do you think you're doing?" She yells back, "I told you that she can't go to the hospital because she has to watch my kids tomorrow." She then starts trying to pull the cot out of the ambulance with our patient on it. Luckily, she didn't know how to unlatch the cot and couldn't get her out. Our patient says, I can't watch your kids tomorrow because I fell, and I might be having a stroke. The entitled neighbor yells back at her and says, "You're fine. You don't need to go to the hospital because you're not having a stroke." My partner then hears the commotion and goes to the back of the ambulance. He pulls her off the cot, and I slam and lock the doors. You could tell that the entitled neighbor was about to become combative. It's important to know that either the police department or the sheriff's department responds to our calls, too, when it's at night. Because of where we were, it took a few minutes for the sheriff's department to show up on scene, but he got there just in time. I couldn't hear much through the door, but I saw the officer get out of his cruiser with his taser drawn. My partner runs back up to the driver's seat and starts heading to the hospital. The last thing I saw through the back windows was the entitled neighbor stomping towards the officer and then her hitting the ground after being tased, super satisfying to watch. I was talking with my patient and asked what that was all about, and she said that the entitled neighbor will just drop her three young kids off at her house and leave for several hours at a time with no notice. My patient had no idea that she was supposed to watch the kids at all because, again, the entitled neighbor never even gives her a heads up about these things. Like I said in the beginning, this happened last night, so I don't have any updates, but I'll post an update when I learn more. Small update. My contact at the hospital said that the patient does not have a bleed. She does, however, have a really nasty-looking bruise on her face from the blood thinners. It's incredibly common. She will most likely be going home soon. There is no update on the neighbor. I probably will not hear anything back until my next shift day. The last story is titled, Why I Hate My Grandparents' Neighbor. TLDR, lady wastes time and makes her kids' project too long. The kids' grade suffers as a result and somehow I'm the a-hole. So, my grandparents live in a gated community. It's kind of expensive so the people who live in there can get a little prissy but nothing as bad as in this story. So I went over to my grandparents one weekend and my grandmother asks me if I could go help the neighbor's kid with a school project. It was about 8 at night, but I can never say no to this woman. I went over, ready to do some work when entitled neighbor, N, answers the door. N. You must be the neighbor's grandson. Thanks for coming by so late. Me. Yay, it's cool. Where's your son? N. He's over there by the computer. He already has the research done, he just needs help making the presentation. I think to myself, wow, this'll be easy. I introduce myself to the kid. He's about 12 and overall, he was a nice kid if not a little nervous. As we're doing the project, N is standing by the counter watching over us and commenting on the work. N. Could you make that picture bigger please? We want to make sure the class can see it. Same with the words. Me. Yeah, sure, no problem. I make the picture a bit bigger and more central and make the words look more like commentary. She chimes in again, a bit ruder. N. Bigger, we have to make sure the people in the back can see it. Me. But if we make it bigger we won't be able to fit the words and picture on one slide. N. That's fine, just make them bigger. Me. Okay, tell me when. The picture ended up taking that whole slide and we had to put the words on a different slide. I start slowly making the font bigger until one of them tells me to stop. She doesn't tell me to stop till I get up to 48 and even then, the words are barely fitting on the slide. N. Perfect, now just do all the slides like that and we'll be done in a jiffy. We weren't gonna be. Every time I tried to help this kid make his presentation look better, hell, even when he tried to make it look better, she had to interject. It was always, make this bigger, I can't see that from here, take that off, it looks tacky. This went on for 2 hours. Finally, we finish. N's kid. This looks great, thanks so much. I can't wait to show this in class. That's when I noticed that the presentation is 36 slides long. There was absolutely no way he was gonna be allowed to present something this long in a classroom. I told him as much and I said the same to the mother. N. No, I think it looks perfect. I'm sure the teacher won't mind his being a little extra long. Me. But he could seriously lose points if he doesn't shorten it or worse, doesn't present. N's kid. I mean, we can shorten some of the less big stuff. N. Fine, if you think it'll get him a better grade, but it's on you if he fails. I was a bit annoyed at that comment, but at least I made some progress. We managed to bring the slides down from 36 to 28, at which point it was hard to compress stuff without deleting sections outright. Now, some of you are probably saying, Jesus, 28 slides for a 12-year-old, that's a lot for a teacher to assign. I do agree, but this story takes place in late-ish January, so I figured it was one of those Christmas break projects that were really long. When I finally take a look at his rubric for the project, I saw something horrible. The assignment called for 8 to 10 slides. I was so upset because we now had to cut out so much. I go to the mother to talk to her about it. Me. Hey, so the project calls for 8 to 10 slides, so we're gonna have to cut some stuff out. No. My child spent hours getting that research and all of it is going into the presentation. Me. But the teacher will never let him actually present that in class, it's too long. Slightly more annoyed. I thought you were working for so long to fix that problem. Me. That was before I knew it was originally 4 times as long as the maximum. Whatever, it's better to go over than under anyways. If he's done with the presentation, you can leave. At this point, it was almost 11 at night and I just didn't have the energy to deal with it anymore. I wasn't even getting paid for this, the most I got was some hot chocolate. It tasted like ass, by the way. About a week and a half goes by and my grandmother calls me, saying she just got off the phone with her neighbor. Apparently, her kid got a terrible grade on the project and it was all my fault. I caught up with the kids a while later, he got a B-. I told her the situation and she hung up to talk to the lady. When she calls back, she says that the lady did confirm that that's what happened, but still says it's my fault. Needless to say, I was not asked, nor did I ever offer to help her again. Thank you for listening.